All right, welcome everyone again. Waiting for a few more to join in. People are still joining. So how many of you have come prepared? As in done a lot of problem practice on work for energy and then attending the session. How many of you have done that? Okay. Only 4 or 5 I can see. 5, 6. Did little from module just now. I mean, it is nothing. It is just you wasted your time. If you're doing just before the session for 5-10 minutes, why are you doing it? Just drink water and come. It is worthless. Okay. You need to make efforts. Okay. It is not that you can just come over like that. When I say come prepared, you have to revise everything that you have done on this chapter 1 year back. Okay. No, 1 hour revision is worthless. Okay. You could have as well not come prepared. Fine. So now, you know, you are towards the end. All right. So don't fool around with yourself. Do only meaningful things. All right. You have lack of time. I mean, are you busy with something else during this time? Those who haven't come prepared, do you have anything else that is going on? Some exams are running or anything like that? No, right? Everybody is free. Okay. So if you come unprepared, it is you who will get worsely affected by it. Fine. So I am cautioning you. I am warning you. I want you to do well. And that is why I'm telling you all of this. Those who listen will do well. Okay. All right. So, let us start the today's session, which is on work power energy. All right. So today we are going to complete this revision of work power energy. All right. Who is this? Okay, people are still joining, so that is why I'm not able to start properly. All right, so this chapter was there in grade 11. Again, if you have joined. Okay, now whoever comes will enter after 5 minutes. Fine, so this chapter was there in grade 11. I hope all of you remember the sweet memories of mechanics and work power energy. All right. And this chapter is a chapter in which we are dealing with motion variables, which are basically not a vector quantity, like work, power, and energy. These are the three things we are focusing on this chapter. And apart from that, we also consider collisions to be part of this chapter. Fine. So let us quickly proceed and continue from there on. The first thing that I would like to highlight is about the linear momentum. Now, all of you might be well versed with the principle of the linear momentum conservation. All right. So it says that if there is some sort of collision between two objects or multiple objects. Fine. And there is no external force. If external force is zero, then you can conserve the momentum. All right. There are cases in which external force is zero along the x-axis, but it may not be zero along the y-axis. Then you can conserve momentum along the x-axis and vice versa. Fine. So basically, you need to find a direction along which external force is not there and conserve momentum along that direction. Fine. Now, when I say external force, when two or more objects, they collide with each other, they will exert force on each other, right? I'm not talking about that force. Any other force other than what these objects are applying on each other. Okay, they might be applying spring force to each other, normal force, friction force, whatever force is between these two when they are colliding. That is not external. External to the entire system. Fine. So when collision happens, whatever is the momentum before and whatever is the momentum after the collision, they are equal. All right. And this is true. The conservation of momentum is true. Like you can say 5 hours before the collision and 5 hours after the collision also. Whatever is the momentum. All right. But if external force is not zero, let's say external force along the x-axis is not zero, but only non-impulsive forces are there, then can I conserve momentum or not? Everyone, do you remember this? External force is not zero, but non-impulsive forces are there. Right? So we can conserve momentum just before and after. We can conserve the momentum. Why? Because only the impulsive forces can suddenly change the momentum. Impulsive forces such as normal reaction, friction, tension, they are the impulsive forces. They can suddenly change the momentum. Okay? But if collision is happening, even though there is external force, but if it is non-impulsive, then also you can conserve momentum, but just before and after collision. Okay, immediately. So all of these things we have already, I'm sure that we have covered it when we were in 11th. Now, when the collision happens, there are some special cases that you need to remember. Okay, so if it is an head-on collision. This is a head-on collision. What is a head-on collision? Head-on collision is the collision when the line of velocities is along the common normal. Line of velocities along the common normal. Fine. When head-on collision happens and masses are equal, then velocities get exchanged. Velocities get exchanged. Clear to all of you? Okay. And there are various cases of collisions, okay? And for example, let's say elastic collision, inelastic collision, and partially inelastic collision, perfectly inelastic collision. So there is something called as coefficient of restitution E, okay, which is defined as coefficient of restitution E, which is defined as the, you remember that what comes in the numerator, velocity of Correct. It is velocity of separation divided by velocity of approach. Okay. And this equation is something which you can apply not only for the collision between the two point masses, but between the two objects which are extended. For example, this ball can come and hit an inclined plane like this. It can come like that and hit the inclined plane. All right. So how you write coefficient of restitution formula then? Suppose after hitting, the wedge goes like this. You need to consider these velocity of separation and approach along some line, right? Along which line will you find out the separation and approach? Good. Good. So you need to consider the separation and approach along the common normal. Remember these things. Good. So oblique collision, just one variation is there in the way the two objects collide with respect to how their velocities are. One is that the velocity is along the line of the common normal. The other variation is when the velocity is not along the line of common normal. Fine. So for example, let's say this object, it goes like this and hits this object. Fine. When this object comes near, okay, let me move this near. When this object comes near and it tries to hit, look at the common normal. Common normal is along this, right? Along this direction, the normal direction will be applied. But the velocity is not along this red line. This is called the oblique collision. Fine. Just a definition. All right. Nothing. Let's say that there is no extra principles or there is no extra law regarding oblique collision. Just it is a type of collision. Okay. You can still use conservation of momentum the way we are using it. And also you can write the coefficient of restitution E. But when you're writing coefficient of restitution formula, you have to find the component of velocities along this red line. Fine. All right. So remember, I'm not teaching you. I'm going very fast because my intention is just to refresh your memories. Are you getting it? So I'm just trying to make you remember those things which you already know. Suppose you do not know something. Suppose you do not know about coefficient of restitution, and this is the first time you're looking at it. Then I would suggest that after the class, you get in touch with me. Okay? Then I can help you. Otherwise, if I start teaching the theory, the entire class will get over and we'll not be able to do any questions. The main purpose is solving problems. All right. Work energy theorem. There are a couple of variations to the work energy theorem. First of all, let us understand what is work. Work is the some change a force can create. And the change in physics is displacement. So if there's a displacement in the direction of force, we say that force has created some change. All right. So work is done by that force. So that is the reason why work done is represented as the force multiplied by displacement in the direction of the force. Here we are assuming that the force is constant throughout. If force is not constant throughout, then we have to use this expression F dot dr to find out the work done. All right. And as per the work energy theorem, it says that if you take a mass and multiple forces are supposed acting on it, okay, you need to find work done by all the forces acting on it one by one. First, you do that. Add all the work done. Total work done on that mass should be equal to change in the kinetic energy. Okay, so work energy theorem relates what is happening right now with whatever will happen later. K2 is final kinetic energy. K1 is initial kinetic energy. So there's a connection between the two points. All right. So this is plain and simple work energy theorem, but there are some modifications also to it. For example, you may like to define something called as potential energy. Okay. Potential energy is nothing but a simpler way of accounting the work done by a special kind of force. Okay. So what we do is that you split the total work done in terms of conservative force and non-conservative force. I hope all of you have heard these terms, conservative and non-conservative forces. What are they? Quick. Conservative, non-conservative forces. What are they? What is conservative force? Right. Conservative doesn't depend. Conservative force. Right. The work done by the conservative force doesn't depend on the path. So if you are at point number one, you are at point number two, you can go like this, you can go like that, or you can go like this. So if it doesn't depend on the path, why should I break my head in finding this integral? Because in this integral, this is dr, right? And this is a dot product. So angle theta will be changing along the path. So why should I find the work done for the conservative force? So that is the thought process of introducing potential energy. So as per the definition of potential energy, work done by conservative force is negative of the change in the potential energy. It becomes a state function. Depends only on initial and final points. K2 minus K1. So what you can write it as, work done should be equal to U2. Delta U is U2 minus U1. So work done is U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. So please understand that this equation and this equation both are same. But in this equation, this W, you have to find work done by those forces for which you are not accounting the potential energy. For example, you account the potential energy for the gravity, don't find the work done due to gravity if you're using this equation. If you're finding the work done by gravity, then use this. You're not using potential energy expression. Okay, so I hope all of you know basics about the potential energy. Potential energy of the gravity is defined as mgh, right? We assume that the mass is small size, much smaller than Earth, which is how most of the objects are. And we are near to the Earth's surface. So Earth for us looks like a flat thing. Okay, so in this chapter, we are dealing with such situations. The mass is small, near to the surface, surface is flat. So this h is the height from where this height is, everyone? What is this h is? Height from where? Height from the Earth's surface, or it can be from anywhere? Height from a reference point or a reference line. There's a difference. Surface, good. It is not line, it is not a point, it is a surface. So, but then usually our problems in physics are two dimensional, fine. So we assume that a surface is line when I'm looking at it in two dimensional. So in every question, if I have to define the gravitational potential energy, I will draw a horizontal line. And that horizontal line for me becomes a reference for the potential energy. So every time I write potential energy, it is a relative potential energy relative to that line. So that line is zero potential energy. Below it, below height h minus mgh potential energy, above height h plus mgh. And that horizontal line, you should not change while you're solving the problem. Once you fix it for a mass, it is fixed for the entire problem. Okay. So this is the potential energy due to the gravity, potential energy due to the spring. I'm sure all of you are experts is half kx square, where what is x, compression or extension? What is x, compression or extension? It can be either. It can be either. Doesn't matter. So you should just look at how much it is deviated from its natural length. That's all. 2 centimeter compression, same potential energy. 2 centimeter extension, same potential energy. You don't need to break your head whether you should take plus or minus and things like that. All right. So enough of the gyan, which you already know. Let's solve a question. Solve this. Gayatri, you are able to join? Gayatri is there? Okay, great. So what is the answer? Okay, so Kinshuk got it. Anusha, Aditya, others, anybody else? That's it. Okay, so I'm sure many of you are about to get the answer, but I'm creating a pressure just to hurry you up and make you aware that, look, others have already got the answer. Okay, so those who are in the middle still to get the answer, it is not that others know more than you. It is just that they have practiced more questions. So you also do a little bit of more problem practice without looking at solutions, and your speed will come up. Anyways, so I hope many of you have typed in the answer. So can I conserve energy between point A and point C? There are two points. A is bullet is not hitting, bullet has not hit yet. B is bullet has hit, and C is the maximum height. So can I conserve, can I use work energy theorem between A and C? Can I do that? Let me take a poll. Can I use work energy theorem between A and C? All right, I'm ending the poll now. Ending the poll now. This is what people have said. Okay. So, you know, work energy theorem is what? Work energy theorem is kind of conservation of mechanical energy. It is kind of that expression. All right. And here, when the bullet hits the mass M2 and it goes inside, right? Ballistic pendulum, fast moving projectile fired into the bullet embedded. Okay, so when it goes inside, don't you think that some heat energy will be generated? There's a high chance the heat energy will be generated. Okay, so some mechanical energy is lost between this event and event B. and Wernicke theorem is not capable to capture it. Fine. So first, you need to reach from point A to B by not using conservation of energy, but by using something else, because mechanical energy is not conserved. Once you reach B, after that, you can go to point number C. Okay. So first step would be conservation of momentum. So M1, what is the velocity? Let's say velocity is V1A, it is written. Okay. This is equal to M1 plus M2 into VB. Right? It goes completely inside. So this is the conservation of momentum. Momentum is conserved. All right. And then I can use Wernicke theorem. And many a times when you use Wernicke theorem, W would be zero. Many a times. And usually W will be the work done by the friction. So once you notice that work done is zero, even this tension, you know, tension will always be perpendicular to the movement. Work done by tension is also zero. Work done by gravity, you're considering it as a potential energy. So whenever work done is zero, you immediately, you can write it as U2 plus K2 becoming equal to U1 plus K1. So I can say that this line is my reference potential energy, UG0. So U2 is M1 plus M2 GH. In case of any doubt, you can start typing. Don't wait for me. This is equal to U10 plus kinetic energy, half M1 plus M2 VB square. So using this, you'll get the value of H. All right. So I have seen many of you have told that you can use conservation of mechanical energy between A and C, which is not correct. Fine. All right, let us move forward. Do this. We are going to have MCQs little later. Right now, I'm just giving you some simple questions so that it refreshes your memories. Done. Okay, let us solve it now. Anyone about to get the answer? Okay, all right. So a railroad of mass capital M that can roll without friction, initially mass small m standing on the car, then the velocity of the car if the man runs to the left. Relative speed is VREL. Okay. So let's say car is moving with velocity u. Fine. Can I conserve momentum or not in this case? This is smooth. Right? I can conserve momentum. But then to conserve the momentum, my observer is standing on the ground. So he is looking at the absolute velocity of the person and the rail. So the absolute velocity of the person is how much? If relative velocity is V rel, if that this is a situation, the velocity will be V relative minus U. Okay, this is the velocity of the person. And velocity of the rail is U. So initially everything was at rest. So total momentum was zero. Zero should be equal to M times V relative minus U plus capital M into U. So what you get U as M into U minus capital M into U, this is equal to small m into V relative. So you get like this, M V relative divided by small m minus this. Right? No, I made a mistake. There is a minus sign here. Momentum is a vector quantity, right? So we can't treat it like a scalar. So minus mu become plus. Clear to all of you? Type in quick, then we'll move to next. All right, let us go quickly. Do this. Whenever a physics question comes, you need to ask yourself, what is the condition for that to happen? They're asking, find the maximum velocity of the wedge. So what is the condition for maximum velocity of the wedge? That if it is not clear, you will not get the answer. So what is the condition that maximum velocity of wedge is attained? Okay. Small m should have max velocity, then capital M would have max velocity in opposite. What does it mean? I didn't get that. Don't you think maximum velocity of the wedge would be when the ball is over here somewhere at the bottom? Yes or no? See, good question. Look at this. What exactly is happening? When the ball is coming down, ball is applying normal reactions like that. Yes or no? Throughout the motion, it is applying normal reaction like that. So there is a component of normal reaction in the horizontal direction. So as the ball is moving down, it is trying to accelerate the wedge in this direction. And as soon as it reaches bottom, the component in that direction, the force vanishes. Acceleration becomes zero. Right? At the bottommost point, acceleration of the wedge on the left-hand side becomes zero. And then the wedges start decelerating because now normal reaction will be in the opposite direction. Does it make sense now? Who was it? Aditya, Weber? Is it clear? Okay. So you can see here that you can conserve the momentum from here to there. There is no external force. So let's say the small m was at rest at the top, capital M was also at rest, so zero momentum. This is equal to m into u for small m minus capital M into v. And then work energy theorem, right? U2 plus K2 is equal to U1 plus K1. There is no external force that is doing work. So the U2 is, let me say that this is my zero potential energy line, the bottommost point where the ball reaches. Okay. So U2 is zero. K2 is half MU square plus half capital M V square. U1 is small MG R. R is given. R plus K1 zero. So solve these two equations, you'll get the value of V, that is your maximum velocity. Okay, someone is asking, can't we also say conservation of center of mass as the reason? Conservation of center of mass as the reason means what? What do you mean by that? Reason for? Since no external force is applied, so what? I didn't get you. Reason for what? Pinchuk? Of course. Yes, yes. It is moving because center of mass should be conserved. Right? See, same thing you can understand by many principles. Fine. So right now we are focusing on momentum conservation. Same thing you can, I mean, suppose I ask you how much the wedge has moved, then you have to do it by using the conservation of center of mass. All right, let us move to the next concept, impulse. Impulse is also a made up concept. Like everything in mechanics, they're all made up concepts, but they help us visualize the scenario in a better manner. Okay. So impulse is defined as a large amount of force for a very short interval of time. Fine. And impulse by the, you can say by the sense of it, can suddenly change the momentum. That is the idea behind it. Impulse suddenly change the momentum. Okay. And if you want to quantify it, what is the value of impulse? The impulse is simply change in the momentum. You can see the entire derivation here. Impulse is defined as simply change in the momentum. Okay. Integral of f dt is the impulse, which is change in momentum. And mathematically, you might have done the this thing, area under the graph in mathematics, right? So integral f dt is nothing but area under the curve. So if in any of the problems, if you get the curve f versus t, whatever kind of curve there is, area under that, you can equate that to change in the momentum. It is change in the momentum, okay? It is not the final momentum. There might, if the initial momentum is zero, then yes, area is the momentum. But if it is not zero, that you have to determine, the area would be change in the momentum. Okay, so let us take a question on it. Okay, it may not be visible clearly. Huh. Now, you want me to draw the figure for this? I can do that. This is a figure. Solve it now. You have to use impulse equation here. Can you conserve the momentum between these two? If not, what is the reason? The reason is this tension force, which is impulsive force. Okay. Just write the equation and let me know that you are done with the equation. People are still joining in. All right, done. Someone is done. Others? Okay, so those who haven't done much of the impulse related question, look at the solution of this one very carefully. Okay. So when this mass M, all are equal masses, right? The block is mass M, pan is equal mass, mass M falls, right? So this is the pan. On this pan, there will be one impulse force T and one more impulse force when the mass hits it in that direction. Two impulse forces, normal force from this when it comes and hits, and tension from the above. Okay, let's say after hitting, it start moving with velocity v immediately after hitting. So this is the situation. So the impulse would be integral of n minus t net impulse force dt. This is the impulse. Okay. This is equal to m times v. Is this equation clear? Everyone, type in. This equation is clear or not? Okay. Then this one, small m. Small m, when it hits, you can see here, I'm ignoring gravity. You can see in the first equation, I'm ignoring gravity. Why gravity is ignored when we write the impulsive force? Because gravity is not impulsive force. Impulsive forces are usually very, very large. I can just give you a sense of it. Suppose you are standing on the ground. Normal reaction is just mg. It is non-impulsive. Then suppose you are jumping from 10 meters. 10 meters is a big height. Okay, let's lower it. From 5 meter, if you jump, then also you can break your bones. Why? Because now it is not the gravity. Normal is not equal to gravity. Normal is way higher. So then during the collision, impulsive force act, normal reaction suddenly raises its magnitude. And that's why we ignore the gravity kind of non-impulsive forces. So on this small m, then you have the normal reaction in opposite direction. That is the impulsive force on the small m. Always take care of the direction. When we wrote the impulse equation for the pan, I'm considering downward positive. That is why normal reaction is positive. Tension I'm taking negative, and m into v is also positive. So there is a sense of direction in all the equations. Okay. For small m, I'm writing n dt. So for small m, I'm assuming upward to be positive. Okay. This is equal to m. Final velocity of small m is this way, which is v. Initial velocity was in the same way, u. So both are negative. So final velocity minus v minus of initial velocity. This is the equation. Second equation is clear. This is for the pan. This is for the particle. Okay. Now for the mass. Mass is experiencing only t upward. And what is its velocity? What is the velocity of the mass m immediately after impulse? Is a constraint? It is constrained to move up with velocity v if it is going down with velocity v. Okay. So integral of t dt is equal to m into v. All right. So nobody is interested in doing the integral part. Okay. So what you can do, you can subtract second and third equation. You can get integral of n dt, n minus t dt to be equal to m u minus v minus m into v. So instead of this, now on the first equation, instead of integral of n minus t dt, you can write this and you can solve it now. M into u, and you open the bracket, it becomes minus of 2m into v. This is equal to m into v. How many of you are getting v is equal to u by 3? U by 3 is the answer. Okay, slightly you can say off the track type of question, because when you hear this chapter work by energy, you feel that it is very welcoming and all the simple questions are there in the chapter. So what is my task? My task is to make you aware that there is a lion in the room. So you should be aware that there are some tricks which are hidden in every chapter. Okay, so can't we just equate change in the momentum? Once you see the answer, you have all kinds of ideas. Getting it? But you can't conserve momentum because impulsive forces is there. Yeah, you may get the correct answer also. Luckily, that's it. You can, why can't we conserve right before and after collision? Because tension is impulsive force, right? T is the impulsive force. How can you conserve momentum for the pan? You cannot. Someone is asking in the example, jumping on the floor, what is the expression for total normal force? See what happens when you jump from here, you hit the floor. So which you suddenly come to rest. So acceleration is in which direction? Tell me. Your velocity is like this. Suddenly it is stopped. Acceleration is upwards. and it is a huge acceleration because you had at least 5 or 6 meters per second velocity, suddenly it comes to rest. So acceleration is huge. So then you write n minus mg is m into a, and normal acceleration is mg plus a, and a is way larger compared to g. So g is ignored. Understood? Okay, so is this? Do this question on restitution. I'll give you options for this. Maybe you guys are feeling that where are the options? Here are the options. Find their velocities. No, I am asking you find the velocity of velocity of 8 kgs. It's a head-on collision, just to make your life simple. Akhil, what is the answer? Akhil? There is one Akhil who has joined us. Okay. Let's have a poll for this first MCQ. We should have a poll. Anyone about to get the answer? Anybody else? I already have many answers. Okay, I launch the poll now. All right, so ending the poll. This is what you guys have said. Nobody wants to take A as an option. B is the maximum. Let us see. Ball of 4 kg moving with 12 collides with a mass of 8 kg moving with 4 in the same direction. It always helps, you know, once you draw the diagram. This 4 kg, 12 meter per second. This is 4 meter per second. Four into 12 plus 8 into 4 is initial momentum. Let's say after the collision, velocities are V1 and V2. This will be equal to 4 into V1 plus 8 into V2. Then coefficient of restitution E, this is 0.5. That is equal to velocity separation. What is velocity separation? Look at this scenario, tell me what it is. Separation. Yeah, Anirudh got it. No. Separation is V2 minus V1. Separation is after the collision. Okay. Approach is what? Approach with what velocity they are approaching? -4. So you have these two equations, equation number one, equation number two. Right. Some of you are messaging that they want to change their answer. You can do that. Who can stop you here? But in the exam, when you write, once you make a silly error, you make a silly error, you can't correct it because you don't know in the exam that you have made a silly error. So option D is the correct answer. Fine. All right, let us move ahead. And something oblique. Let's just write the equation for this and move ahead. Okay. There are many small, small concepts in the chapter. I don't want to miss any. So we are not finding the final answer for this. Just write the equations. And let me know once you're done, then I'll write the equations. Done. Rashmika is done. Others? All right. One is 2 kg, other is 4 kg, same radius, and this is going with 4 meters per second, and this is going with 2 meters per second, and they collide. E is equal to 1/3. Find the final velocity along the line of impact. All right. So now let us say their line of impact velocities after the collision. This way. So I would assume that, let's say the 4 kg mass, 2 kg mass, all right? The 4 kg mass has velocity of V2 along the line of impact and V1 perpendicular to it, okay? And the 2 kg one has, let's say, V2 dash along the line and perpendicular to it is V1 dash, fine. So first thing I can do is conserve the momentum along the green line So this angle, what is this angle? Everyone, how much is this angle theta? Everyone, find out what is that angle? Pi by 4. Huh? Is it? This distance from here to here is 2r and this is r. This angle theta is such that sine theta is half. So theta is 30 degrees, pi by 6. Okay. So when we conserve the momentum, 2 into 4 into cos of 30 degrees minus 4 into 2, this is also 30 degrees only. Cos of 30 degrees. This is the momentum, initial momentum along the green line. This should be equal to, I'm considering downward to be positive, right? So 2 into V2 plus 4 into 2 into V2 dash this. This is the first equation. How many of you got this equation correct? Okay. Only one. Fine. Perpendicular to that line, the momentum is along this line, the initial momentum is 2 into 4 sine of 30 degrees. And minus 4 into 2 sine of 30 degrees. This question is actually slightly above level compared to JEE mains, but then it is good to know all these concepts. Okay. This is equal to perpendicular to that. I have assumed that direction positive, right? So minus of 2 into V1 dash minus of 4 into V1. Two equations of momentum. I have taken along the normal and perpendicular to the normal because they're asking velocity along the normal only. So I have to consider that way. And coefficient of restitution. Let us see how many of you got that correct. That is more important. Just let me create a space. E equation, E, which is 1/3. Velocity of separation is what? What is velocity of separation? What you will write in this case? Correct. V2 minus V2 dash. And velocity of approach? With what velocity they are approaching each other? Good. Four cos 30 plus two cos 30. All right. See, this component coming towards, that component also coming towards, they're both, the both components along the normal, they come towards each other. So they will add up, right? They're approaching each other. Fine. All right, let's move ahead. Kshitij, you are making all kinds of errors possible. All the possible errors you are making. Not leaving any kind of error. Yeah, yeah, only three equations and you will get the answer. Fine. Next topic is the circular motion. Circular motion, when it is done, it can be uniform motion, non-uniform motion. All right. So uniform motion is a situation in a circular motion in which the speed is constant. Fine. In non-uniform motion, speed is not constant. Speed varies. Fine. So how you tackle these situations? In circular motion, we tend to use the angular variables. For example, let's say a uniform circular motion like this, velocity is constant, right? So what is changing is the angle. It has reached here and an angle theta is made. So if we track theta, we will be able to find out everything about the particle. So that is the reason why we write, let's say if it has traveled a distance of S. So you know, by the definition of the angle, S by R is equal to theta. So S is equal to R theta. And rate at which the distance, this is not displacement, this is distance. Rate at which distance is changing is the speed, which is equal to R d theta by dt. So if you track the angle theta, you can find out the speed easily. So it will be R d theta by dt is omega. Speed is R omega. Okay. And we also have learned that whenever circular motion is there, there must be a radial acceleration, which is equal to u square by r. So u is r omega. So it becomes omega square r, radial acceleration. All right. So tangential acceleration is not there in the uniform circular motion. All right. In a non-uniform circular motion, at every moment, whatever is the speed, the radial acceleration would be speed squared divided by r. Okay. At the same time, there would be tangential acceleration. Tangential acceleration is rate at which speed is changing, not the velocity, speed. Okay. Take the magnitude of the velocity and differentiate that, you will get the tangential acceleration. The rate at which magnitude of the velocity is changing is the tangential acceleration. This is equal to R d omega by dt. D omega by dt is alpha, R alpha. Okay. So non-uniform acceleration, two accelerations are non-uniform motion. In a circular, there will be two acceleration like that. Now we are using angle theta to understand the circular motion, but the equations of motion which we have learned, they were in terms of displacement, velocity and acceleration. So if you're if you are tracking the angular variables, there should be equations on the angular variables, so that you can derive easily by defining omega as d theta by dt, alpha is d omega by dt. Now this is the definition, they will be always correct. Just like velocity is always rate of change of displacement, acceleration is always rate of change of velocity, no matter acceleration is uniform or non-uniform. Similarly, this is the definition of alpha and omega. Alpha is also equal to d omega by d theta. Okay, when you solve this differential equation for constant angular acceleration alpha, you will get omega equals to omega naught plus alpha t. Okay, omega square is equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha delta theta, and delta theta is equal to omega naught t plus half alpha t square. I'm sure all of you have seen these equations many times in grade 11. Is there anyone who hasn't seen these equations? No one. Good. So I have seen questions in the computer exams where they will ask you to find the angular velocity. Suppose in this case, let's say there is a rod. Okay. rod of length L, it is given. And so this is the situation. The two points, point A and point B, they are moving in the given way. B is moving like this, and A is going like that. This is V2. This is V1. Theta 2. Theta 1. Okay. First, tell me, what is the relation between V1 and V2? Is there any constraint relation between V1 and V2? If rod is of fixed length, everyone, correct, velocity along the rod should be same. Good. So V1 cos theta 1 should be equal to V2 cos theta 2. If V2 cos theta 2 is more than V1 cos theta 1, the length will become stretched. If it is less, length will get shrink. Both are not happening. This is that. Now, if you talk about the perpendicular component velocity, they need not be equal. The perpendicular component of velocities, they may be different. If they are equal, the rod just moves straight up without rotating. Okay. If the perpendicular components are not equal, if let's say V2 sine theta 2 is not equal to V1 sine theta 1, then the rod starts rotating. The rod will rotate. Let's say V2 sine theta 2 is more. So the rod after some time becomes like this. After some time it will rotate like that. Fine. So how you find omega? To find the omega, the best way is you stand here at one of the corners. You can stand anywhere actually, doesn't matter. But if you stand on one of the corners, it will be better because you already know this corner's velocity. So once you stand on this corner, you'll be seeing the relative velocity of the other corner with respect to u. So you will see what velocity? V2 sine theta 2 minus V1 sine theta 1. Okay. So this corner will try to describe a circle keeping u as a center, because whatever it does, the length should be fixed. So it will become a circular motion. And V2 sine theta 2 minus V1 sine theta 1. If this is the tangential speed, this should be equal to omega times radius, which is L. So omega is this. Okay. So I've seen question in which they ask you to find omega only. Okay. You may be wondering that what this has to do with work, power, and energy. But then somewhere you have to study circular motion, right? So little bit of it we have studied in motion in 2D, and little bit of it we study here. And if you're writing an exam, which is computer exams, when you look at the question, you don't think that which chapter it belongs to. Same question can belong to multiple chapters. So it is all mixed up, jumbled up. You don't need to worry about it. But will we get same result if we stand at the center of the rod? Of course. Yes. When you stand on the center of the rod, you must know what is this velocity. Let's say this velocity was x. Now you will not observe V2 sine theta 2 minus V1 sine theta 1. You'll observe V2 sine theta 2 minus x. Okay. You'll get the same answer. Try it yourself and message me if you don't get the same answer. The hint is the rod is a rigid body, omega is same everywhere. So you can write the center point velocity in terms of omega, and then, I mean, it will be a little lengthy, but still you can try it. Do this, everyone. Should I give you the options for this? Yes, I can. So option number A is omega sec square theta. B, this is omega, okay? Whatever is given to us. 2 omega sec square theta C, 3 omega sec square theta D, 4 omega sec square theta. All right, so some of you got the answer. Charan, you're guessing. He's saying yes. So I am not here to make you learn how to guess. Okay. If you have to guess, you don't need to attend the classes. We are here to learn. Do it properly. Okay. So let us do it now. A spotlight S rotates in a horizontal plane with an angular velocity of omega. Spotlight P moves along the floor at a distance 3 meter. Find the velocity of spot P. So whatever is the velocity of a spot P, that is equal to rate of change of this distance or not? All of you agree that dx by dt is velocity of point P? Everyone? Right? It is that. And you can write x as 3 tan theta. Right? 3 times tan theta it is. So when you differentiate, dx by dt is equal to 3 sec square theta d theta by dt. D theta by dt is omega, so 3 omega sec square theta. Option C. Okay. I hope it is clear. Let us move forward. So I'll circulate this PDF after the class. I'm skipping some questions because of the lack of time. This PDF has more than 70 slides, I think. So we can't do everything. Okay, so sometimes I have seen that in the question, they will ask you to find radius of curvature. All right, now I know that you have that differential equation form of finding the radius of curvature, but they don't expect you to use that. So you don't need to memorize it. Fine. Radius of curvature is simply if you find out the perpendicular component of the acceleration, whatever is going on, if you find the perpendicular component of acceleration as in perpendicular to the velocity, at that moment, whatever is a perpendicular component of the acceleration, that should be equal to speed squared divided by radius of curvature. That's how the, if it is moving in a circle, centripetal acceleration is u square by r. That is how it is defined. So if radius of curvature is r, no matter whether it is moving in a circle or not, if you find out the perpendicular component, this direction, if you find out the acceleration, this acceleration should be speed squared divided by radius of curvature r. Okay. How many of you have seen question in which you need to find radius of curvature of the projectile motion at the top of the projectile? How many of you have seen that? Okay. If you have not seen that, you haven't done a lot of problem practice. I mean, you have not done enough problem practice, because it is seen regularly nowadays in almost every textbook. Okay, banking of roads. Banking of road is again nothing new in terms of the concept. There is no new concept here. Same concept, laws of motion is applied to find out what is the minimum velocity with which a vehicle should be moving so that it doesn't skid. All right. So when you bank the roads, then the maximum possible velocity becomes larger. Okay. If you don't bank it, when theta is zero, the maximum possible velocity is root of mu gr. But if you bank it, you'll get this. Okay. And I think there's a minus sign in the denominator. I'm not very sure though. Should be cos theta minus mu sine theta. But anyways, just verify this in case you are relying on this. I think there should be a minus in the denominator. Okay, so this is the banking of roads. Don't worry, there will not be a direct question on it. But this is a good situation to analyze the movement and understand how you can apply your concepts. Conservative force, non-conservative force, we already discussed. Okay. Then, all right. There are these kind of questions that are asked. Try solving this. I'll give you options. For which part the answer is The answer is for the second part. Second. Okay, some of you got something. Let's try to solve. Force is k y square I cap plus x square k x square j cap, right? So work, this force is not constant, so work done is integral of f dot dr. Dr is what? How can I write dr in terms of I cap and j cap, everyone? Dr would be dx I cap plus dy j cap. Okay. So the work done would be equal to integral of k. Correct. So k y square dx when you take a dot product plus x square dy. Now what to do? Everyone, what to do? So the you need to get some relation between x and y. Otherwise, you will not be able to solve this. Fine. So how will you get it? You are going from 0 to AA in a straight line like this. Fine. This is what? Y is equal to x line. So throughout the motion, y is equal to x. Throughout the motion. If y is equal to x, even dy is equal to dx. Fine. So this is equal to integral of k, y is equal to x, x square dx plus k, x square dy is dx. So x goes from 0 to a. X goes from 0 to A. So we'll get the answer as D. Clear to all of you? Type in quick. How it is clear? I mean, do you think it will come out to be this? You know, easily we can induce silly error. Easily. You can say you want to get the answer quickly. If that is the mindset that I should quickly get the answer somehow. I don't have time. I'll get the answers by doing something. Then you'll make a silly error every time. That is how these exams are designed. Okay. X squared dx integral is what? X cubed by 3. So there is a factor of 3. All right. First question, first part, consider it as homework and try doing it. Very similar way you have to do it. First, find the work done from here to here, then find the work done from there to there and add them up. Okay. Try it yourself. Let me know. Okay, then we see some questions related to the equilibrium. Yes, yes, first part was homework. Okay. Type of equilibrium on the basis of stability. Okay. So equilibrium means that the net force is zero. Fine. And there can be many kinds of equilibrium. They are called stable equilibrium, unstable equilibrium, and neutral equilibrium. For example, this one. If you take these two examples, let's say a ball is here at rest. This ball and that ball, both are in equilibrium. But if you push it a little bit, it will not going to come back. It is going to go away. But this one will come back. So a stable equilibrium will do oscillations. Unstable will not do oscillation. It will just go away. Fine. But both are stable. Sorry, both are in equilibrium. This one is unstable. This is stable. And if you keep a ball like this here, this is the neutral. Fine. How will you check whether it is a stable, unstable, or neutral? See, the fact is that if you move this way, the force has to be in the opposite direction. All right. All right. Force should get created in the opposite direction. Then it is stable equilibrium. Now, how will you check that? We will check that by finding out if df by dx. This should be positive or negative for stable, everyone? Df by dx. You changed dx little bit. It should be negative. It should be negative, right? And do you guys remember force is equal to derivative of x like this? Do you remember this? Right? So double derivative of the potential energy, that should be less than zero, or double derivative potential energy, if it is greater than zero, you say it is a stable equilibrium. Okay. And if double derivative of potential energy is less than zero, you say it is unstable equilibrium. So many a times in the numerical, potential energy is given as a function of X or Y. So you have to do all of this circus to find that out. Okay. Anyone has any doubts? Quickly type in. No doubts? Let us take a question on it. Double derivative, if it becomes zero, neutral. The F is not changing with X. Find out this one. All right, others? Good. Force is equal to minus of du by dx. This kind of derivative, I hope you know, when you do this kind of partial derivative, you're considering other variable to be constant. Like for example, if y would have been there, y is treated as a constant when you differentiate like this. This is equal to minus of 2ax plus b. When this is equal to zero, it will be an equilibrium situation. So x is equal to b by 2a. This is a point of equilibrium. Now, whether this is stable or not, we can find it out by taking a derivative of the force. Df by dx comes out to be minus of 2a less than zero. So it is a stable equilibrium. Okay. Or if you are very mathematically driven, you don't want to, think. So you can, as a matter of fact, just find out the double derivative of potential energy. This should be greater than zero. Okay. You can memorize it like this. All right. So it is a stable equilibrium like this. Can any situation, there can be more than one stable, unstable? Yeah, why not? There can be many. Like this. Unstable, stable, unstable, stable, unstable. And I can draw one neutral also. This is neutral here. Somebody asking, sir, double derivative positive for stable. Double derivative of what? Double derivative of what? Double derivative potential energy is positive. Okay. And derivative of the force should be negative. Force is equal to minus of du by dx. Negative of the derivative of potential energy is the force. So that is why one is positive, other one is negative. Now, let us get into the objective type of question, MCQ. I think I have now all questions. I'm done with the pointers which I have to highlight. I think I have told you few things which you might have forgotten or you do not know. So now we will be solving questions from anywhere in this chapter. And sometimes, you may learn some new theory from the question itself. So do it. So here I have not told you power is what? Power is rate of work done, right? This is equal to also F dot V because work done is F dot dr. So when you do dw by dt, it becomes f dot dr by dt. So f dot v it becomes. Just a basic theory. Okay, many of you got the answer. Let us see. Body of mass m accelerate uniformly from rest to velocity v1 in time t1. Instantaneous power delivered to the body as a function of time. Okay, so here, I mean, it is roughly we are assuming that acceleration is constant. So acceleration is v1 by t1. This is actually an average acceleration, but we are assuming that it is a constant. So the force is mass m's acceleration, mv1 by t1. Okay. So the power is force times velocity. No, velocity, this is the v1 in time t1 power. Yeah, this is v1 only. But I have found out the average power. Sorry about that. Okay, I have found the power at that instant. Let's say at any moment, the power is m into v1 divided by t1 multiplied by velocity after time t. So velocity after time t is initial velocity is 0 plus at v1 by t1 into t. So you will get m v1 square by t1 square into t. Okay, so option one. But then yes, it should be, it is written uniformly. Okay, I assumed it is uniformly, which was correct. Good. Everyone, this one, do this, everyone. Yeah, you may get dimension analysis by using that. You may get the answer during the practice, but in the exam, trust me, you will not get the answer by using dimension analysis because they are smarter than you, at least all of us, even me. So they will definitely give at least two or three options which have the same dimensions, and one of them will be correct. Okay, here also I can see many of you got the answer. Is it very straightforward? Car of mass M has engine which can deliver power P minimum time rest to speed V. Okay, so power is dw by dt. Okay, work done, basically if I am using the maximum possible power p, right, for minimum time t, I have to use maximum power possible throughout the motion. Power is a constant then, so work done is p into t, right? Work done becomes P into T. And what else we can write here? minimum final speed is V. So work done is the change in the kinetic energy. W is change in kinetic energy, half mv square. This should be equal to P into T. Right? So T would be equal to mv square by 2P. So option number one. Okay, I hope those who got the answer, they have done it properly without dimensional analysis, because trust me, in the exam, there will be one option like this, other option like that. So all this will have the same dimension. You can't rely on dimension analysis to solve problems. Do this, everyone. Anyone close to the answer? All right, many of you got some answer. Let me proceed. So if I look at the graph, the two things should strike me, the area and the slope. Okay, you should start thinking about area and the slope. There is something which has to do with the area or the slope. Here it is F and T. We know that the area of F and T is what? What is the area of FT curve? Change in the momentum, right? So initial velocity is 5 meters per second, body acted upon a time dependent force like this. So the area, you have to consider the sign of the area also. Downward area is negative because force is negative. So 20 into 5 plus half of this base is 5. Height is 20, and this is also same, right? 25, yeah. So into 2, and this is also same. So in fact, into 3. How much is this area total? Anybody got this? 100, 15 to 3, 150, 250. Oh, I told that consider a sign and then I myself not considering a sign. Minus, sorry. So 100 minus 150, minus 50. All of you got it? Minus 50? Sometime I make silly errors. Pardon me. So this area is 20 into 5 plus half of 5 into 20 minus of half 5 into 20 into 2. Right? 150 minus 100. 50 plus 50. This is equal to change in the momentum. Final velocity is, let's say, V. So 2 into V minus 5. Okay. So 25 is equal to V minus 5. Final velocity is 30 meters per second. We have to find work done. And sometime, you know, they will not write 20 here. They may ask you, what is the work done in 15 seconds? So we are in so much hurry in getting the answer. We don't even read till what time they're asking. So we'll do it like this, which is completely wrong. And then there will be an option sitting there. It will make you believe that you're right, but then you're not. So carefully read the question. They're asking 20 seconds, right? So that is all fine. But they may ask you 15 seconds. So then you have to take area till here only. Anyways. So work done is what? Work done according to the work energy theorem. Work done on a body means work done by all the forces, including gravity and friction and spring and everything, is equal to K2 minus K1. That is half M into final velocity square minus half M into initial velocity square. How much you get this? $875 is the answer. Okay. All right. Let us proceed. I think you might have seen this question somewhere, but still do it. Okay, Archit got it. Pradum got it. Shall we discuss now? Okay, let us discuss. power is constant. Power is rate of work done. Okay, since power is constant, the work done is power into T. So power into T is change in the kinetic energy. It starts from rest. So final kinetic energy is half mv square, initial is zero. This is what it is. Okay. And what we are trying to find out? We are trying to find out displacement S as a function of V. Okay, till now, displacement has not come in the equation. And we need to bring it up. Power is equal to force into velocity, which is mass m acceleration into V. Right? So if you substitute it over there, m a v not like this. This is a constant, right? This is a constant. So acceleration, I need to bring S in the equation. So acceleration, I can write it as V dV by dS into V. This is a constant, which is power. Okay. So M V square dV is equal to power into dS. That I don't need to do this. So when you integrate this, 0 to S, 0 to V, power is constant, so comes out of the integral. So M V cube by 3 is equal to P into S. You can see that S is proportional to V cube. Option number 3. Okay. I hope it is clear. Let me go to the next question. We can write F dot S here. What do you mean by that? Acha, for, no, you are assuming force is constant. Power is constant, right? Power is constant. Velocity can change. Force can change. Multiplication between velocity and force is a constant, not force. This one, you want to do it? Okay. This is, I mean, we'll come back to this. We have done enough of power now. Let us do something else. Power is a small topic. Do this. If time permits, we'll again come back to those questions which we have skipped. All right, many of you got the answer. B these are some of the questions which you should not get the wrong answer. It is moved slowly. So at every moment, velocity is almost zero. Okay. So the total work done on the mass is zero. So work done by the force plus work done by the gravity should be equal to zero. Change in kinetic energy is zero. The work done by force is WF. Work done by the gravity is minus MGH, because gravity force is down, displacement in that direction is opposite to it, zero. So work done by the force is plus MGH. Okay, let us take a 5 minutes break. We'll meet after that. All right, so let us continue. We'll move forward. This one, quick. Everyone, this is very simple. All of you should, okay, let me put a poll. I'm ending the poll now. Only spring force is there. All right. So you can see the poll result. Those who have marked A and B, you haven't come prepared today at all. Answer is D. Okay. I have to share the results. This is the result. Fine. Many of you have picked A and B. A is the majority. Answer is D. So we have discussed, right? The work done by the spring force is half K X1 square minus half K X2 square. You remember this? Depending on X1 and X2, if the spring is already extended and you move this way, so spring is doing positive work, it is pulling and moving also this way. If a spring is in natural length, you're moving that way. So spring is doing negative work, spring force is this way, but pull is that way. Okay, so depends on initial and final position. It may be positive or negative. This is the formula for the work done. Okay. These kind of questions, when you see in the exam, your eyes will light up. You'll be like, oh, very simple, a theoretical question. I don't need to write the equation. But these are the questions in which maximum people will get it wrong. Do it. Done, anyone? All right. Let us solve this. Consider system coefficient of friction is mu. System is released from rest. Find the work done by the friction. Now, in this case, friction is doing positive or negative work? Okay, all options are negative. So we cannot eliminate that way. Speed of the block is this. When the speed is this much, it is released from rest. So accretion is what? Accretion is 2mg minus mu mg divided by 3m. How much it is? Anybody calculated this acceleration? 5. Okay, you get 5. So, distance traveled is half 80 square, half. No, not that way. Well, final velocity is given. So, we'll use this to get S. So, 10 square is equal to 0 plus 2, 5S. So, S is 10 meters. The work done by the friction is minus of mu mg into 10. Okay, so 0.5, whatever it is. What do you get when you do it like this? Option 4, right? All right. So that is the answer. You can see here kinematics is mixed. Not only kinematics, laws of motion, kinematics, work by energy, all the chapters are there. Okay, so most of the questions in the exams will be like that. Do this. This looks interesting. But this one is, I think, question from laws of motion. But anyhow, do it. I do not know whether it is laws of motion or whatever it is. Try getting the answer. All right, let us see. What is the maximum compression of the spring if the lower spring is shifted rightward with acceleration A? How many of you have picked this option? Option 3. Option 3 is not correct. Okay. Why? Because condition for maximum compression is what? Maximum compression, if you have equated forces, then that's not correct. Maximum compression is when the relative velocity of m on the plank should become zero. That is a condition. Okay. So yes, it is work energy chapter's question, not laws of motion. So what we'll do is that, we'll apply the work energy principle while standing on the lower block. But when you stand on the lower block, there will be a pseudo force acting on the small m, with a force of m into a. Okay. So on this block, I can apply work energy principle. So work done on block M in my reference frame should be equal to change in the kinetic energy. In my reference frame, it was at rest. And when the final compression, the maximum compression has reached, then also with respect to me, it should be at rest. Otherwise, it will keep on moving backwards, right? So work done on the mass M by MA force is MA into X. And work done by the spring is minus of half kx square. This should be equal to zero. So answer is two. Is it clear to all of you? Type in quick. Is it clear? I can explain it to you in another manner. Okay. Let me explain it to you in another manner. So when you stand on the lower block, the upper block, the small m, will do oscillation or not? Will do SHM or not? Everyone, will it go like this? Will it start performing SHM? Because pseudo force is applied, right? So when you equate pseudo force with kx, what is that? What is that? Is that a mean position? It's a mean position. So however much further it was initially at mean position, that much further inside it also it will go. So extreme positions are on the both sides of the mean position. So at the mean position, the compression is MA by K. So it will go further by MA by K this way. Clear now? Yeah, you have to change the frame of reference and understand. Every time, those who are in a hurry to get the answer will make this mistake of equating forces for maximum compression. Okay, I am sort of warning you that if you are in a hurry, you will not do well in exams like JEE. You should be calm and composed. Okay, relaxed. Fine. And if you get a simple question, don't run over it. Give it full respect. Try to get the correct answer, then move ahead. Difficult question, you may not get the answer. So simple question, if it is there, make sure you tick the right option. Do it. All right, shall we discuss now? Arnav and Kinshuk have answered. Others? In 30 seconds, I'll put a poll. Here comes the poll. ending the poll. This is what you guys have done. You know, what kind of question will affect your marks in a worst possible manner? The questions which everybody gets right, but you got it wrong. Getting it? So those simple questions in which you make silly error will hurt you the most, because 10 lakh people will get it right and you got it wrong. So 10 lakh people are ahead of you immediately. Difficult question, if you get it wrong, you might be behind, let's say 5,000-6,000 people. But simple question, if you get it wrong, you are behind by lakhs. Okay. But at the same time, if you get difficult question right, you will be ahead by 10 lakhs. So it is a tricky scenario, but making a silly mistake in a simple question is a crime, and you'll pay for it for rest of the life. Okay. Don't do that. Kinetic energy is half mv square. Now this is what, k versus x. So I told you that whenever there is a graph, it is all about area or slope. So if you see ABCD, the difference is in terms of slope or something like that. So you tend to find the slope of the kinetic energy in terms of x. Dk by dx is the slope of k versus x graph, which is half m to u du by dx. So u du by dx is what? This thing is what? Acceleration, m times a, which is, so wherever the slope of k versus x is highest, acceleration is highest. Where it is? At d. It is highest, almost like a vertical line. Okay. A. Oh, you say A as in acceleration, not option. Now, this is the kind of question which you have seen so many times, right? This you can do it. If you've done basic problem practice, you might have solved already 3-4 times that kind of question. Do this. Okay. Let's do it. X is equal to 50t minus 5t square. We need to find work done on the particle, so work done by all the forces. So, I mean, if you correlate with x is equal to ut plus half at square, you'll clearly understand that acceleration is minus 10 meter per second square. Or you can do a double derivative of this x. Differentiate once, you get velocity. Differentiate again, you get acceleration, which is minus 10. So the force is, it's a constant force. Mass is 2 kg, so 2 into 10 minus 20 newtons. Work done by the particle in first 5 seconds, what will be the x? X is 50 into 5 minus 5 into 5 square. So 250 minus 125, 125 meters. Right? So x is positive, force is negative. Work done will be negative. So minus 20 into 125, so option number 2. So here somebody is asking, here does negative direction of force only means in the negative x axis? See, you have taken x coordinate and this is half of A. And this is what? This is a vector equation. You're treating like a scalar equation, but it's a vector equation. So minus sign means what? When x is positive, it's negative. So they're in opposite, the acceleration is in opposite direction of x. So acceleration is in the direction of force. So they're in opposite direction. Clear? What if x is negative? If x is negative, then force is in the direction of x. You can see, let's see what is happening is, this is the kind of thing that is happening. Initially, the object is, let's say, moving at 5 meters per second, hypothetically. But the acceleration is in this way. So what will happen? It will move up to certain distance, then turn around, and then start going in that direction. So till it turns around, the force and displacement are in the same direction. But once it turns around, then the change happens. Never call it deceleration. Deceleration is a made up concept to make sure that standard ninth kids understand a little bit about the kinematics. But in reality, deceleration will ultimately lead to acceleration only. Initially, it will decrease the velocity and then start increasing the velocity in the opposite direction. This one. Okay. Oh, many of you got the answer. Is this? Force is given if the potential energy is asked. Okay. So you know that negative of the work done by the force is change in the potential energy. Good thing is that it is assumed that at x equal to zero, potential energy is zero. So from ax dx, so ax square by 2 comes out to be potential energy. When you put the limit, u1 is zero. Yes, option 2. How it is option 4? In option 2, it comes out to be ax square by 2. Check this. Let's do something different. This one. Power. Where is power here? It is potential energy. There is no power here. Do this. Forget about the options, solve it properly. I'll tell you all the shortcuts at the end. Right now, focus on learning. Okay, shall we discuss now? Nishchal, Aditya, Dhanush. They got it. No one else. All right, let us discuss. So what will happen? This block will try to track the hemisphere and it will leave the hemisphere at certain angle. Let's say it leaves it here. Do you remember what was that angle? What is this angle, theta? Oh, I have to take attendance. Okay, yes, good that you remember that, but we will derive it. Let's say here when it leaves it, its velocity is v. After leaving, it will become a projectile and travel like that. Okay, so let's say before leaving, it makes an angle theta. So this distance is r minus r cos theta. All right. So we can use the conservation of the mechanical energy. The work done is zero by any external force. Gravity is doing work, but we are considering potential energy for that. Okay. So let's say this red line is, let's say, my zero potential energy line. So U2 is zero, K2 is half mv square, U1 is mg r1 minus cos theta, K1 is zero. Okay. And if it is leaving at that point, then what is the condition for that? If it leaves, the condition for leaving any surface is normal reaction and friction becoming zero. Okay. So normal reaction, you can equate along that direction, n minus mg cos theta, where there is an acceleration also. So mg cos theta, acceleration is towards the center, minus n is equal to mass times acceleration. Acceleration is centripetal acceleration towards the center, v square by r. So if it leaves the surface, normalization should become zero. So when you put it as zero, you can substitute the value of mv square over here, and you will get the value of cos theta to be equal to 2 by 3, right? 2 by 3 is what you will get. Then after that, it becomes a projectile motion. It's as simple as this. You know, it's like this, where this height is r sine theta. It's like height of the tower is r sine theta, and the velocity is this way. So the projectile will travel like this. This velocity is v, and this is theta, that is theta. So this angle will be 90 minus theta, with that will be theta. So this angle is theta. Okay. Wait, you need to just find r sine theta. Need to find the horizontal distance between the point where it leaves and the point where this, right? You have to find that distance from here to here, that distance range you need to find out. Am I correct? The body starts slipping, the horizontal. Oh, sorry. Yeah, I did not read it completely. You just need to find that distance. Correct. You just need to find that distance. What I was trying to find was this distance. It leaves here. Then I was trying to find that distance, which is, you know, which is, and I was wondering why this is an objective question. So that distance is actually r sine theta. Cos theta is 2 by 3. Sine theta is root over 3 square minus 2 square divided by 3, that is sine theta into r. So option number 1. Okay, it cannot be 3, right? Because that distance can't be more than radius. It cannot be 2. It can be either 1 or 4. What if wedge is not fixed? Then it will become little lengthy. That's all. So you want to try it? Try it after the class and we can discuss it then. Do this. Anyone close? Okay, let us solve it. See, will this block, block B, will ever leave the floor if the spring is compressed? It cannot. It can only leave when the spring is extended. And if it leaves, the normal reaction should become zero. So let's say it leaves, there will be extension in the spring. So extension is, let's say, X naught. No, X only. So Kx should be upwards. Then only it can leave. Okay. And Mg is downwards. There will be normal reaction. So Kx plus normal reaction minus Mg should be equal to zero. Condition for it leaving the ground is N becoming zero and X becoming equal to Mg by K. And this should be extension. Okay. Now let's go back. So at present, if let's say F is zero, if F is zero, spring is compressed by Mg by K. Nothing will happen. Okay. So it has to move up by Mg by K. Okay. Then go up by another Mg by K. Do you all understand? If it moves up by Mg by K, natural length will be there. Then it has to further go up by Mg by K so that this lifts off. Is this clear to all of you? Type in. Okay. Now, as of now, this mass is in its mean position. Net force is zero. Mg and spring force are balanced. But if I push it down from its mean position by a distance of 2 mg by k, will it be able to reach 2 mg by k above also? Will it be able to reach here? Yes or no? This, at present, it is at the mean position. Considering the oscillations, okay? So if you want to further compress it by 2 mg by k, you need to have a 2 mg force. Type in, is this clear? Now you can do that energy equation and all those things. It will become a little complicated. But this way you can get the answer quickly. Okay? But how is this minimum force? Minimum, see, if you have more force than that, it will go beyond 2 mg by k up. So your extension, the spring will be more than mg by k. Fine? Don't worry, I'm going to put this recording at this location. You can understand from there. You can watch the recording also if you want. I mean, you should watch it once again. Those questions which you found that something completely new, watch it again, because you can't just learn immediately. But unfortunately, we have to move ahead. We can't just harp only on one question. Do this. Can the answer be more than one? Can the fraction be more than one? Of course, no. So you can remove these two. Okay, so let's move ahead. A neutron traveling with the same sum velocity collides with a nucleus of mass number A. So the mass of neutron is M. Then mass of the atom is A times M. Fraction of total energy retained by the neutron. So we are assuming that the atom is at rest. Neutron is traveling with velocity U, M, AM. After colliding, M into U plus AM into zero. So initial velocity is zero. M into V1 plus AM into V1. It is an elastic collision. So velocity of after the collision, this is V2. This is V2, and this one was moving with V1. So E, which is equal to 1, velocity of separation V2 minus V1 divided by velocity of approach. So you have two equations. V2 minus V1 is equal to U, and V1 plus AV2. That is also U. Is it? Okay. So using these two, you'll get V1 and V2. So the energy of the neutron would be half M into V1 square divided by half M U square. This is the answer. Okay. And it comes out to be option one. Okay. So I think this was direct only. Don't make mistakes in these kind of questions, fine, where you just need to have conservation of momentum and conservation of energy. All right, should not make a mistake in that. Okay. Let me give you one question, my own. better to use E. Yes. If you use the energy, then you get a quadratic equation, right? I think we discussed it many a times. Why you want quadratic equation? Okay, Arnav is saying, if mass is much greater than neutron, doesn't the nucleus remain at rest and neutron bounce back with double the velocity after collision? Not double the velocity, with the same velocity. That is correct. If A is very large, but that is not happening here. We are not assuming that the way the options are put over here, we are not assuming that. Fine. That is an assumption. It should be written that A is very large. Like that, it should be clearly mentioned. All right, everyone. This is a liquid of density rho. Then there is a cube of density sigma. Sigma is less than rho by 2. Okay. So what you're doing is you are pushing this block. You're pushing this block down like this. Side length is A. You're pushing it down so that the top surface coincides with the level of the water. And then leaving it. You need to find the velocity of the block as it comes out completely. Find out. Last thing for today. Up to what height H it will be already submerged? Shall I do it now? There will be a buoyant force, rho, the volume submerged, A square X into G. Gravity force, sigma A cube G. Not X, H. both are equal, it is balanced. So rho a square h g should be equal to sigma a cube g. So h is equal to, but why we need to find that? All right, so now when I'm pushing it down, let's say I have pushed it down completely, and at this moment it is x outside. I need to find out when this x becomes a, so that it is completely outside, right? So right now it is x outside. The net unbalanced force, which is in upward direction because it is moving upwards right now, is buoyant force. Let's say this is x buoyant force, which is rho a square a minus h. You have to take the volume that is submerged, g minus sigma a cube g. Here x will be there, a minus x g. This is mg force. This one is mg force, and this is the buoyant force. Net force upward is this. This is equal to mass times acceleration. Acceleration, you can write it as v dv by dx. All of you getting it? What are I'm saying here? Type in, are you able to understand? So v dv sigma a. Now I have to use integral here, rho a rho minus sigma g a integral of dx minus rho g x dx. Just rearrange the terms. X goes from 0 to a, 0 to a, velocity goes from 0 to v. Okay, just spend a little bit more time with this question. You will learn something new. Okay, because till now, we never considered that even fluids can do the work. Okay, but the buoyant force is just like another force. So even buoyant force can do the work. So that is what we have done here, just to demonstrate that. All right, so I would say that's it from my side. We are done with the basic 1% of, not even 1% of revision of the work per energy. It takes a lot of time to completely understand the chapter. And I hope you guys have done that hard work. And we'll meet next time and we'll take the next chapter then. All right. Bye for now. You can't consider it a spring. Okay. Looks like a spring kind of force, right? Proportional to x. Don't do that. Shortcut would lead you to the wrong answer. Bye for now. Yes, it will perform SHM. It will. We have done this type of simple harmonic motion last year itself. Bye for now.